Hello, friend. So glad to have you with me today. I am going to be talking about the power of your story. Did you know there are individuals in the Bible that Jesus actually told them to go tell their story? The Apostle Paul told his story again and again. We're going to look at that, and then I'm going to share with you a bit of my story. So put your seatbelt on, put your crash helmet on, and away we go. Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers. You know, one of the things that I love about the Gospels is the stories. In fact, the whole Bible, it's filled with the stories of people. People like you, people like me, they faced similar things. In some cases, they faced dissimilar things. But we see God intervening in their stories, God intersecting their lives. And, you know, I mean, they're on their way to hell. God intersects their life, and they're on their way to heaven. There's destruction and depression and illness, and God intersects their lives, and it turns the other direction toward blessing and health and peace. And I want to tell you, God can intersect your life, my friend. I don't think it's a coincidence that you are watching me right now, that you're listening to my voice. No, it's not a coincidence. And yes, I am speaking to you. There's a God in heaven that knows your name, and He wants to intersect your story so that you can go and tell someone else about the mighty things that He has done for you. I sit here today in front of this camera coming into your living room or to your hotel room or wherever you might be watching or listening to this from, your mobile device. And I just want to tell you, I sit here as a trophy of God's grace. If not for His mercy and His intervention in my life, I would not be here. Sometimes I think to myself, you know, it's pretty much a miracle that I lived long enough to get saved, the way that I was living, the crazy lifestyle that I had, the many near-death experiences that I had due to my own foolishness and the foolishness of those around me. You know, the Bible says, a companion of fools will be destroyed, but he that walks with wise men will be wise. Well, I used to be a companion of fools, and I shared in destruction to a degree, but God had mercy on me, and here I sit. You know, there is an amazing story in Mark chapter 5. It's one that you may have heard about, perhaps you haven't heard about it, but it's about a demon-possessed man that lived in the tombs. And I know some people right away think, oh, well, you know, that's just like Bible times. No, my friend, demons are real. Demon powers are real. I think today we dress them up and we'll put someone maybe in a psych ward, and really the problem is spiritual. It's not just some, emotional problem or, you know, some physical problem, something wrong with the brain. That may be the case, but it is not always the case. And we have this man here. It says, they, talking about Jesus and the disciples, Mark 5 and 1, they came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gadarenes. And when he had come out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains, and the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces. Neither could anyone tame him. And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying out and cutting himself with stones. That's a pretty dramatic story. And again, you may be thinking, well, yeah, but yeah, I've never seen anything like that. Well, I have. You know, I was, as a young Christian, I'd moved down to Mexico, was involved in missions work. And we were helping an evangelist put on a crusade in a rural area. And literally, they kind of carved away the side of this hill, made it flat, put these cinder blocks with wooden planks on them. Yeah, I think it maybe seated 1,000 or so out there. And an evangelist, you know, would come and he would preach every night. And the evangelist happened to be a friend of mine. Well, one day there was a guy up on the top of the hill. It was during a daytime session. And he started throwing huge boulders down into the crowd and throwing boards with nails sticking out of them down into the crowd. And he was jumping up and down like a wild ape. Turns out his name was Jorge, and he was demon possessed. He was up there, and I still distinctly remember there was one woman in the crowd. She was very pregnant. She got hit with a big board with a nail in it. And this guy is dancing around like a wild animal, throwing stones and big boards with nails in them, you know, down into the crowd. And somebody looked at me and said, "Bayless, go take care of that." And I thought, there must be another Bayless around here. But they were talking to me. And I'm a young Christian, but I have read in the Bible, you know, about evil spirits. And I have read in the Bible that Jesus said, "These signs will follow those that believe in my name. They will cast out demons." And friend, I am a believer in the name of Jesus. So I marched up to the side of the hill, and there was this guy. Man, his teeth were pointing north, south, east, and west, and I think they were sharpened. And he is slobbering, and he's got a board with a nail in it, and he's, you know, I mean, he's going crazy. And I just pointed at him, and I said, "In the name of Jesus, sit down." Boom, he hit the ground, and he sat down. I went over to him, and I laid hands on him. I commanded the demons to go, and you know what? They went. Now, later on talking to him, I actually had to talk to him through an interpreter. I asked him if he knew what heaven was, if he knew what hell was, and we talked to him about Jesus. And he said, "I know what hell is." I'll never forget his answer. He said, "It's like being burned constantly with a fire, but never being able to see the fire." Yeah, that kind of stuck in my mind. But anyway, Jorge wasn't too different. He was known in the villages and the mountains there, that mountainous area where we were, you know, as a demon-possessed guy. He didn't live in a home. He was wearing ragged clothes, and he was a menace to everyone, as this guy in Mark chapter 5 was a menace to everyone that came his way. And so this guy, they've chained him. They've hunted him down like an animal many times. They've subdued him, put chains and shackles on him. But he pulls the chains apart. He had this supernatural strength. He breaks the shackles. But now Jesus and the disciples arrive by boat. And this demon-possessed guy runs out. Verse 6 says, "When he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshiped him. And he cried out with a loud voice and said, 'What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you by God that you do not torment me.' For he said to him, 'Come out of the man, unclean spirit.'" Goes on as the story unfolds. This guy didn't just have one demon. He had one controlling demon, but a whole lot of other unclean spirits in him as well. Jesus cast those evil spirits out of this man. They went into a herd of swine, about 2,000 pigs that ran down a steep hill and drowned in the sea. It was quite an event. And it says in verse 14, "Those who fed the swine fled. They told them in the city and the country, and they all went out to see what it was that had happened. Then they came to Jesus and saw the one who had been demon-possessed and had the legion sitting and clothed, and in his right mind, and they were afraid." Now, we read the other gospel stories, we find out this guy didn't wear any clothes either. And so, you know, he's naked, he cuts himself with stones, he torments, you know, everyone that comes around there, everyone's afraid of him, he's got this supernatural strength, and now he's clothed, he's sitting, he's no longer agitated, and he's in his right mind. My friend, Jesus can put you in your right mind. And if you're watching me right now, maybe you can relate to a story like this. I would suspect that there's someone watching me that when I said demons are real, you know what I'm talking about. You've messed around in the occult. You've messed around with witchcraft or whatever, and you've gotten yourself into a heap of spiritual trouble. Listen, let me tell you, Jesus Christ is bigger than the devil, and he can set you free. You can be free from that oppression. You can be free from those voices that you hear all the time. Jesus Christ loves you. In fact, in his mighty name, I say, be free and be free now. You can be like this man, sitting at peace, clothed and in his right mind. And everyone that was afraid, you know, the people came out, they saw, they knew who this guy was, they were in awe, and then they thought, well, man, we've lost quite a bit of income here, and all these pigs have drowned in the sea, and they asked Jesus to leave. It says in verse 18, when he got into the boat, he who had been demon-possessed begged him that he might be with him. However, Jesus did not permit him. That's an interesting thing. Now, I get it. You know, man, Jesus sets me free like that. I want to be with him. Now, thank God now, you know, he is here present with us by his Spirit, and we can be with him. But Jesus then was limited to one geographical location at one time. He's already got the 12 disciples. He had another 70 that he had trained. And Jesus didn't permit him, but he did tell him to do something. I want you to listen to this. However, Jesus did not permit him, but said, go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he has had compassion on you. I love one translation. Jesus said, go and tell your story. There's power in your story. It says, and he departed and began to proclaim in Decapolis all that Jesus had done for him, and all marveled. And Decapolis literally was a region of 10 cities. This guy went through a region of 10 cities, and apparently everybody in that region knew him. And he began to tell them how Jesus had mercy on him and what the Lord had done for him. Go home to your friends. Go home to your people. Go home to those that know you and tell them how the Lord has been merciful to you. Tell them your story. Imagine what that must have been like. People that had known him, that had seen him. How did he get in this state? I don't know. You know, maybe he started messing around with the occult and ended up, you know, demon-possessed. Maybe there was some traumatic event that happened to him that broke him down emotionally and opened up a spiritual door in his life. I don't know. We're not told. But we are told the results, and everyone either by word or by sight had known of this guy, that he's a wild man, that he cuts himself with stones. He cries out day and night. He screams and he wails like a wild, wounded animal. Can't be bound with chains. Everyone is afraid of him, and suddenly he shows up, and he's not naked. And he doesn't have a wild look in his eyes, and he's not covered with filth. His hair's combed. His beard's combed. He's clean. He's got a smile on his face. Did he have a family? I don't know. Maybe he did. I imagine him if he goes and knocks on the door and the children run screaming, his wife runs screaming. He says, honey, yes, it's me. But I've been set free. A man named Jesus had mercy on me. The demons are gone. Sweetheart, it's me. Please come to the door. I don't know. Maybe that was part of his story. People that he'd grown up with, people that he'd known, he went and told throughout Decapolis, a region of 10 cities, told them about the mercy of Jesus, told them about the power of Jesus, told them his story. Maybe he shared what it was like living in the tombs. Maybe he shared the dark thoughts that he had and how he didn't have control, you know, over his own body. Maybe he told all that, and maybe he shared about the moment that he heard the voice of Jesus say to the demons, come out of the man, you unclean spirit. Oh, what a thrilling story it would have been. And you know, it's interesting because Decapolis is only mentioned one other time in the Gospel of Mark here. It's sometime later, and Jesus comes back to Decapolis, this region of 10 cities, after the man has been sharing his story. And interestingly enough, Mark is the only one of the Gospel writers that records this story. In Mark 7 and verse 31, it says, "Again, departing from the region of Tyre and Sidon, he came to the midst of the region of Decapolis to the Sea of Galilee. Then they brought to him one who was deaf and had an impediment in his speech. And they begged him to put his hand on him. And he took him aside from the multitude, put his fingers in his ears. He spat and touched his tongue. Then looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, 'Ephrathah,' that is, 'be opened.' Immediately his ears were opened, and the impediment of his tongue was loosed, and he spoke plainly." Now, the last time we read, all these folks in Decapolis, they're saying to Jesus, "Please, go away from us. We don't want you here." They send him away. But now when he comes back, people from this region are bringing a man that is deaf, has an impediment in his speech. Could that be the result of the ex-demoniac story? Maybe they heard him tell about the mercy and the kindness of Jesus, and suddenly they get wind. After all this time, Jesus is back in the area again, and they think, "Let's take our friend." Maybe this guy was born deaf, and as I was reading, doing some studying here, some of the references said that it literally means that he was born deaf, had never heard a word in his life. And so he has an impediment in his speech as well. Maybe it was a separate thing. Maybe it was because he had never heard a sound that he couldn't speak properly. But Jesus healed the man. And again, Mark is the only one that records it. Would we have this story in the Bible if the other guy hadn't shared his story? My friend, I'm telling you, there is power in your story. You might think, Bayless, I don't have this dramatic story. I may get into it a bit right now, or I may just the next time we're together talk to you a bit about my story. But even if yours is not dramatic, like, this demoniac, or perhaps like mine, there's a bit of drama to my story and how I came to Christ. You might be sort of opposite end of the spectrum, that one day you realized you needed a savior. And you'd done your best to live an upright life, to pay your taxes, to be a good citizen, to be, kind to animals, whatever, to be a good father, a good husband, good wife. But one day you realized you were lost and undone without the salvation that Jesus Christ provides, because the Bible declares all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so you came to Jesus and got saved. Did you know there are a multitude of people that need to hear your story, because they're running down that same track. Some of them think, I'm a good person. I don't try and cheat anyone. I don't lie. I try and be honest in my business. Certainly, if there's a heaven, God will let me in. My friend, it's not through our good works that we get to heaven. And someone needs to hear your story. That's my wife. I came out of a background of some pretty severe substance abuse and alcoholism, and I was involved in the occult and just a bunch of stuff. My wife, on the other hand, she's a farm girl from the Midwest. She had 9 siblings. One of them died as a child, but she still has 9. There are 9 of them altogether, 9 siblings that are living. A couple of her brothers were career farmers. Her daddy was a career farmer and, lived a pretty simple, life out in rural America. And she tried to be a good person. But one day she realized that she was just as lost as someone like me. Somebody that had lived a crazy life and done a bunch of stuff wrong and maybe done shameful things. And one day she realized that she was lost and undone without God's son. In fact, I think she was about 10 years old, and she had some neighbors that were Christians. They were Baptists. Thank God for the Baptists. Half of the world wouldn't be saved if it weren't for the Baptists. And this precious Baptist family, they would give her these Sunday school lessons from church. They'd be 3 or 4 pages long, and there would be Bible stories in them. Janet kept them under her bed as a little kid, and she would read them from cover to cover. And they actually even took her to church. And one day, they were talking about heaven and talking about hell. Somebody says, well, that's not a good thing to share with little kids. Well, friend, heaven and hell are real. You know, heaven is real, hell is real as well. And Janet made a decision that day that she wanted to go to heaven, that she wanted Jesus in her life, and she gave her life to Jesus as a 10-year-old girl. Now, she never had any teaching. She never grew spiritually, ended up kind of going her own way till she was in college. And she had a roommate that was a believer. And her roommate started going to a charismatic Catholic Bible study. And she told Janet, said, look, you know, it's a bit different. And one week a nun teaches, and the next week this pastor teaches, a local pastor teaches, and the teaching is just so good. You have to come. And Janet started going, and the teaching was so rich. They were teaching from the scriptures, teaching the scripture as the final authority and as God's word to us today. And it transformed her life. She rededicated her life to Jesus, and she ended up getting filled with the Holy Spirit. You know what? People need to hear stories like my wife's story, just like they need to hear my story. And you sitting there right now, listen, you have a story. It may not be filled with drama and intrigue, but it's your story, and nobody can tell it like you. God will empower your stories. You weave the gospel seeds into it. You know, the Bible says, how can they believe in him in whom they've not heard? How can they hear without a preacher? How can they preach except they be sent or unless they go? We've got to open our mouth and we've got to tell the gospel story. And you might feel, well, I'm not qualified to, you know, to preach doctrine. No, you can tell somebody about Jesus. You can tell somebody that Jesus saves. You can tell somebody what Jesus Christ has done for you. And it can change their life. God will use it. You know, when I got saved, I immediately went to all of my friends and told them about Jesus and about what Jesus had done for me. It freaked some of them right out. In fact, I had one friend, he and I got in a lot of trouble together. We actually got arrested together in Nevada one time. We traveled and lived in another state for a while, and we did a lot of drugs together. He was a very, very close friend. And I got saved. And I went and I shared my story with him. And I'll never forget what he said. He said, Bayless, if it was anybody else, I could have just dismissed it. But it had to be you. It had to be you. Meaning that I know who you are. I know how you've lived. Because I've known you for years, and I see the change in you, and this is undeniable. And now it's like he's basically saying, now I've got Jesus on my hands. What do I do with this? It had to be you. And some of my friends rejected me out of hand. I remember it was my best friend when I got saved. And this is true. We had not been apart for more than a year. We had been apart, for more than one day over a year period of time. We were that close. We just, you know, we were just together. We did everything together. And we traveled up to, you know, a mountain in a snowstorm to listen to this lady that claimed that she talked to aliens and flying saucers. We practiced, you know, Native American religions together. We did drugs together. We were together all the time, just close friends. And I got saved. I got saved in a street mission, radically saved. And I shared Jesus with him, and he didn't want anything to do with it. I finally talked him into coming to church with me, and he reluctantly came. I was going to this little Pentecostal church. And, you know, of course, I want to go sit up in the front row. So we're like there was people in front row. I think we were sitting in the second row, but we're sitting up front. And suddenly the presence of God came into that service in a tangible way. And I'm sitting there crying like a child. I'm sobbing as I sense God's presence so thick and so real. And I turn and I look at him, and he has a look of stark terror on his face. He's looking at me, and suddenly I realize that he realizes that this thing is real. There's something to it. He sensed the presence of God as well, and it scared him. And he jumped out of the aisle, climbed over a couple of people, literally ran out of the back of the church. And from that day on, whenever I saw him, he would pretend like he didn't see me, and he would cross the street, go to the other side, so he wouldn't have to interact with me. I'm talking about my best friend. He would have nothing to do with me after that point, because he realized that this thing was real. And if he was going to deal with me, he'd have to deal with Jesus. And still to this day, and that has been, oh my, 47 years ago, I still pray for him to this day. Now, that was sort of the reaction of a number of my friends. They didn't want to have anything to do with me. Another group of my friends that came to Christ, they got saved, kind of divided into two groups. Two of them abandoned me. Half of them abandoned me. The other half gave their lives to Jesus. I had another dear friend. I talk about doing drugs. Well, it was just what we did. That was the lifestyle I had. We had known each other since high school. And he comes over, to the house one day. I was living in another state, and I'd gotten saved and came back to California for a while. And he comes over, and he's got a big bag of cocaine. He says, "Bayless, I got some coke. You want to do a few lines?" I said, "Man, I don't do that anymore." He said, "What?" I said, "I don't do it anymore." He said, "It's free. I'm not going to charge you anything." I said, "Look, I don't do that. I'm high on the Most High. Jesus Christ has changed my life." And I witnessed to him. And he went home. And then I get a call late that night. And he says, "Can I come over?" I said, "Sure." He comes over. And he says, I couldn't get away from what you said. I knelt down and I accepted Jesus. I said, "You did?" He says, "Yeah, but, I had that whole bag of cocaine. I couldn't bear to flush it down the toilet. So I snorted the whole thing." So he comes over to the house. He says he's accepted Jesus and he's high on coke. But you know what? As crazy as that sounds, that was the end of drugs for him. And he's still serving Jesus today, all these many, many decades later. But the power of your story, I just told him what Jesus had done for me and what Jesus was willing to do for him. And my friend, you need to know, Jesus will change your life. He can set you free from whatever has you bound. He can put your feet on a pathway of blessing and peace, and he wants to do it. You are loved by God. Don't you ever doubt it. Well, friend, I hope that you got something out of that. And I didn't actually get to the heart of what I wanted to talk about. So you're gonna have to join me next time. I'm gonna be sharing a bit of my story and perhaps in some detail that you have not heard before, if you have heard any parts of my story before. So we don't want you to miss it. And until then, I pray that God's richest and his best would be yours always. We'll see you again.
We've all made mistakes. Too many times we let those failures define the way we live. We let the disappointments of the past shape our future. You don't have to let your past define you. It's time to turn those mistakes into miracles. In Bayless Conley's inspiring booklet, Turning Mistakes into Miracles, you'll discover the essential principles needed to overcome yesterday's failures and move forward into your purpose and destiny. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com, you'll learn how to rely on God in times of trouble, how to recover from tragedy, and how to find peace in God's love, available in physical, digital, or audiobook formats for just $12. Turning Mistakes into Miracles will inspire and challenge you to live the life you were created for. No matter what you have experienced in your past, everyone has made mistakes. But oftentimes, we allow our past, people, or even pride to discourage us from pursuing God's plan. When you go online to BaylessConley.com and get the book, Turning Mistakes into Miracles, you will learn the spiritual truths and practical steps to move forward in your life. You will understand, with God, all things are possible. Don't let your past define you. Go online right now to BaylessConley.com to get Turning Mistakes into Miracles. That's BaylessConley.com. Go online right now.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.